BioBalance HealthCast, episode 254, Surviving the Emergency Room.
BioBalance HealthCast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, medical director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor.
Everybody I know has an emergency room story, either something that they've experienced themselves by going to the emergency room, or someone that they care about has gone to the emergency room, and then talk about the stories. And we live in a large urban area with a lot of hospitals. And what I have learned, because I've had several friends who've had emergent conditions, and my wife had one in the last 6 months, I've learned that there are five levels of trauma care that divide emergency rooms. Emergency rooms are ranked according to the condition of service and the quality of care that they can provide for an emergency. And in St. Louis County, which we live in St. Louis, Missouri, in St. Louis County there is one level one trauma care center, although there are a dozen hospitals with emergency rooms. And then after the emergency rooms, there are dozens of urgent care facilities, which are a step down from emergency room, but a step above a doctor's office or a public health clinic at a place like Walgreens or Costco or Walmart or one of those corporate entities that are providing intermediate care. And part of all of that is a reflex action of the system trying to adjust to changes in the way people consume medicine and medical care. Then in 1987, the United States Congress passed the EMTLA Act, EMTLA, Emergency Medicine, Trauma, and Labor Act, which basically said that hospitals with emergency rooms have to take and treat anybody that shows up. So if you have a large subset of urban poor who don't have health insurance and don't have regular physicians that they have relationships with, they tend to abuse the emergency room system by showing up for regular medical care at the emergency room. So if they've got a severe cold, if they've got a bad cough, if they've got a headache that they consistently have, whatever it might be, an infection of some kind, they don't go to their regular physician to get that treated because they don't have one.
Or Walgreens, because sometimes you have to have insurance or money.
Right.
But this law made it possible
to show up and say,
everybody to show up for any reason, which has flooded our ERs.
And in large urban centers, they often just call an ambulance because they may not have transportation either.
Which
floods
the ambulances.
So that ties up the ambulance systems. And so the police and ambulance distributors have to try to triage over the phone. Where do we got five ambulances that are on call. You call, I call, he calls. Which one do they send first?
So triage, we have to describe some of these words, but triage means who is the sickest person. So doctors do that when they're residents and they've got people coming in and being admitted to hospitals. They have to go to the sickest person first, and they may have to leave a patient who's not deathly ill to go to someone who is, and can then come back. So we triage in our heads all the time. Emergency room has to. They give the sickest person, no matter what level of pay or what is happening, the first attention.
Well, as a regular citizen, I hear the words emergency room and I think rabbit's foot. You know, that's where you go when you don't know what to do, and you know, they'll take care of you. As a physician, you are trained to understand that emergent treatment or acute versus chronic intervention means something medically. So so what does that mean to you as a physician? Because for me, it's like, well, it's 7:30 at night. I don't want to call my doctor at home. I'll just go to the emergency room.
Yeah,
if I don't think I can wait.
And what that does to the doctors is, and I mean, because many people come and have their emergency room stories centered around, oh, the doctor didn't do this or didn't do that. They have my compassion because, first of all, the doctor can only do what he has or she has in their hospital. If their hospital is level one, they've got everything. If they're level two, three, four, five, they have less facilities. That's basically, and less on-call people. They can only do so much in those other levels.
Well,
and you don't know what they are.
They have to divide that between adult and pediatric.
Right. And they have to do both. In some of them, not everybody has to take care of pediatrics.
Right.
Certain levels don't. Okay. So we've got emergency care that is, it's basically unknown. It's a secret. You guys don't know where you're going or what you're going for. So basically, if you have something life-threatening, my advice to my friends is you go to the level one trauma center. I mean, I can help triage. Are you really that sick or not? Your primary care can help triage and say, if you're really sick, go to this hospital. But not all of them realize even the levels of trauma care. I had to look it up to make sure that our hospital, Mercy Hospital, was the only trauma center so I could give advice to my friends. So emergency, what should be used as an emergency in all cases is something that is life-threatening in the next 24, 72 hours. Something, some situation that might get worse and cause you to be damaged for life, like a stroke, might not kill you, but it might leave you with a deficit, or a broken arm that has a bone coming through, it has to be operated on, or appendicitis, or an ectopic pregnancy, things that I did that have to be dealt with immediately. So those are just examples of things that are emergent. Now, you're not a doctor, so we're going to try to educate you so that you can make good decisions. So the first thing that you have to do is know what an emergency is and find the different emergency room levels. And if you feel like something is minor, then go to urgent care. Go to your doctor. If it needs stitches, that's urgent care. Or if you need an x-ray, that's urgent care, unless you think it is life-threatening. Now, first, the other thing is you were talking about acute and chronic problems.
Yeah.
In general, an emergency room is for an acute problem, meaning it is short-term. It just happened. It is something that you haven't had before, and all of a sudden, boom.
Yeah, it's a whole new thing in
the
universe.
It's a whole new thing. You've the worst headache of your life. That's huge. You have to go right to the emergency room. And you better find one that has a neurologist and a neurosurgeon, because you might need one. So that's a level one trauma center.
Part of why we're talking about this, it might be helpful to know that before you get that headache.
Right. That's right.
So you have an
you
idea
should
where
know
I go.
Which hospitals you should go to ahead of time. You should look them up, because it's not easy to find. I mean, we were trying to find how hospitals documented what level they are. Not all the hospitals except the level one trauma documents that.
Right. They'll shout it from the rooftop, we're level one. The others are like, we have an emergency room. Come on in.
So we were looking at that. And, you know, that also tells you the level of education for the people that are taking care of you. So,
but it changes, and it changes. It's a fluid environment all the time. Several years back,
you're not helping them by telling them it changes. Tell them how it is now. But okay, you can tell them how it happened.
Well, it's a moving target. I was thinking about what you were saying about acute versus chronic.
Yeah.
Several years back, I got a spider bite on a Friday morning early. I was still in bed. Mm-hmm. And a spider bit me. And I was leaving town Friday, so I was a little concerned. I called my regular physician mm-hmm. after office hours started.
Which is totally right.
And said, I got a spider bite, and I'm leaving town. So what should I think about, or is there anything that I should do? And she said, I'll send you an antibiotic, start taking it.
Mm-hmm.
And if this or this or this happens, go to an emergency room. So I was gone until Sunday evening, and when I got home Sunday evening, my leg was swollen probably twice its size, and it was bright red, and I was in severe pain. So I told my wife, I don't think I can wait until office hours tomorrow to go and see her. I'm going to the emergency room.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to the emergency room.
And your doctor told you to do that.
Yes.
So you had some prep for what to go to the emergency room
for. She knows
for.
I need to be led gently.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I go to the emergency room, and the emergency doctors look at me, the triage nurse, and then they bring in a doctor because it's really kind of unusual. And they tested my white blood cell count, mm-hmm. and the doctor looked at me and said, if you had not come to the hospital within the next 24 hours, you would die. And I said, I am not systemically ill. I don't feel bad, except my leg hurts. How can you say that to me? And he said, because you have this massive infection that is almost out of control, and now we can't treat it with take-home drugs. You have to stay here and get IV antibiotics. Mm-hmm. And it took a magic marker, literally a magic marker, and drew a circle around the red area on my skin.
He had cellulitis from the spider bite. That's it wasn't just the spider bite that was a problem. It was the infection that he was getting, and it was a probably staph or strep or combination that was rapidly getting bigger. So at home, if you have a red cellulitis and it's as big as the palm of your hand, mark it with a magic marker see if it is getting worse. And if it's getting worse, you've got to go to the ER. So let's just keep that in the back of your mind.
And that's an acute, unusual occurrence. Yes. Just happened, couple days, boom, never happened before. Mm-hmm. It's not a chronic condition.
And it wasn't really the spider bite that's the problem. It's the infection. So when you started getting red, that's when that clock started ticking.
Right.
So acute means it happens, okay, in the last couple days, or a condition that you've always had, like chronic, and your doctor said, you have this condition if you can't see out of your eye.
Right.
Go to the ER. You might need retina surgery.
Right.
If your doctor gives you these parameters, remember them. Write them down if you can't remember them. If I get this,
or tell your wife.
I'm to go to the ER, and then my doctor told me, and here's my doctor's name, and you know, that kind of thing, so that they can get your records from your doctor's office. But so an emergency room is for something new and severe. It's for trauma, like a car accident or falling off. We used to always in the fall have all these people falling off of ladders when I was doing the emergency room. And I was actually certified in emergency room care for a year. When we had a lot of knife and gun clubs at my hospital, and they needed an OBGYN because they kept getting women with knives stuck in their pregnant bellies. So I had to know how to handle that because I was a surgeon, and so I had to take care of that. So I had to get emergency room training, which I did, and it's hard. I mean, just to be a regular doctor, not an emergency room trained.
Somebody like yourself sitting there with all the training. Mm-hmm. Somebody like me comes in, I have no medical knowledge, and something's wrong. And I'm trying to explain to you what's wrong. And you're looking at me, you don't know me, you don't have my history, you don't know what meds I'm allergic to or what I'm on. You know what I've told the receptionist and the triage nurse, which may or may not be accurate.
So we ask you again and again.
Yeah, and hopefully you get consistent, informative answers. But you're going through a decision matrix to eliminate possibilities. Well, it obviously isn't his heart, but it's probably his head. You know, and so you narrow your focus, and then you order tests. But you have a limited, for a lot of these circumstances, you have limited time to make a decision.
You do. And so emergency room, you almost have to have some knowledge about what's going on before you decide. Yet, so that's what we're giving you the parameters
for. That's what we're talking about today.
We'll be more specific ongoing, but you have to know your emergency room. You have to, the right emergency room to go to, or urgent care, whichever is your pick. Then you have to know, think about whether it was acute or chronic. If you've had this, you know, I confess, my dad loved the ER. He got attention. And and I would always say, Dad, don't go to the ER because you're cold. All of a sudden, you're feeling cold all over. I mean, and you've been feeling that way for a month. And then all of a sudden, on Saturday night at midnight, you need to go to the ER. So that's not how this works. And that's not what it's for. He didn't listen to me. And sometimes people in my dad's generation, in their 90s now or 100, would not listen.
Right.
Having said that, you have to be smart, and you have to be a smart consumer. We all have to be if we are to be able to unclutter the emergency rooms and go for the right treatment. If you go for something that's minor, they may not act very interested because it's really not their thing. They should, but I mean, they're tired and they're...
Well, especially if you go to a level one trauma center. If you go to a level one trauma center in an urban environment, it's going to be like a crowded bus station. And they're going to have multiple treatment options for adults and for pediatrics. Mm-hmm. And then they often will have an urgent care step down that the receptionist or the triage nurse that greets you will make those preliminary decisions and filter you into food chain somewhere.
Which
and you get a number
you
and
have
sit
to.
In the hallway and wait. And if something more emergent comes in, like a gunshot or a car wreck, then they bump you back. And my son was an emergency room supervisor at a level one trauma center. And he said, Dad, if you ever, like the spider bite thing, mm-hmm. if you ever have that again and you're not getting any response after you've waited what you think is a reasonable amount of time, tell somebody you're having chest pains because you're a 65-year-old man and that'll get their attention because of the triage.
Only if you're dying.
Well,
because then the team comes in and right. then you're not dying.
Right.
They're going to leave you in that room for hours.
Yeah.
Only if you're dying. Don't play that card unless you're dying and they're not hearing you.
Right.
Because I had an ectopic pregnancy when I was, I don't know how old, 38. Ectopic means I had a pregnancy in the tube after in vitro fertilization. They just went into the tube and grew. And then an ectopic pregnancy, when it's in the tube, ruptures the tube and you bleed inside.
Okay.
So you have a belly
full. It's not in the womb. It's not where it
normally
is.
Not in the uterus. It's in the tube and it has to be removed or you die.
Okay.
It's not a question of.
Yeah.
It's not an abortion.
It's a true emergency.
It's a true emergency and you can die fast.
Right.
And I had this when I was in a town for a party 2 hours away. And I was hosting the party for my mother-in-law, and I took a friend aside, and I thought either I had appendicitis or that. It was just terrible pain, and my belly just kept getting bigger and bigger. So I knew I was getting blood or something in my abdomen, mm-hmm. so I could barely walk. So I just told her to take me to Mercy, the place that has that level one trauma, or to blank, you know, a couple other hospitals.
Mm-hmm.
And if I passed out, to take me to the first hospital she came to.
Right.
Because in that town, there was nothing. There was no trauma, no level one, anything, two or three. I mean, it was a small town. So I thought I could get back. And I did. But then I got to the triage area. And I'm a doctor on staff there. And I went, it's a Saturday. And I walked in calmly and said, I think I have appendicitis or ectopic pregnancy that is ruptured. I need to be seen as soon as possible. And she says, yeah, yeah, yeah. And then she had an earache come in, and she had a cough come in, and she had like 3 or 4 or 5 other people come in. No triage. I mean, those can wait.
Mm-hmm.
They've been there. They should have gone to a different kind of doctor anyway, and I should have been brought in. Bad triage. So then I went to the desk, and I raised my voice like I'm in terrible pain, and you don't understand because I'm not screaming that I'm in terrible pain. But I am in terrible pain, and I think I'm going to pass out. Then I got put back into the ER. So it is kind of what you say and how you act. And if you're extremely calm, which we
you
like, and you want to be, sometimes the person at the desk doesn't hear it in your voice, so they don't think
squeaky
you're
wheel gets the grease.
Telling the truth. You have to, if you aren't going to be upset, then you have to say in words,
mm-hmm.
like, I have never had this headache before. It is the worst headache of my life. I think I'm having a stroke. I think I'm having a something,
mm-hmm.
you know, or I just hit my head on the bathroom tub and I feel like I'm going to pass out. That's big. And,
so,
you know,
that's
going to get you in.
But being able to say, I have this condition with some intensity, doesn't mean that you should be panicked, hysterical, or angry.
No.
If you're any of those things, they will dismiss you. They'll discount that in trying to factor what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important that you have some knowledge and information about how to conduct yourself in an emergency room and do your own pre-triage. I mean, ideally, you have a physician, you have health insurance, you have regular health maintenance care so that you can distinguish yourself. Is this an emergency? Should I go to the Walgreens clinic and get a flu shot because I'm, you know, it's flu
yeah,
season?
Yeah, that's not exactly.
And not go to the emergency room to get one.
Absolutely.
And so you need to have some common sense and do some of these things. But if you end up in an emergency room or if there's a need to go to emergency room and you're trying to make this decision, we want to talk to you about some ways to present yourself, ways to understand what's going on, ways to talk to those people, and some keys that you should know before you leave the emergency room. So if you come back next week, that's what we'll do. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.